MedCram.com.
Well, welcome to another MedCram.com board vitals question. And this one comes from the Family Medicine Board Review Bank. Another great question here. A 55-year-old male presents to the ER with left-sided facial droop. His symptoms started 5 hours ago at work and were noticed by his coworkers. The patient has an elevated blood pressure at 170 over 101. He does not take any blood pressure medicines. He reports excessive stress due to illness in the family. He also has a headache for 2 weeks, which mostly subsides after a good night of sleep. He was sick with flu-like symptoms 2 weeks ago. What is the best test for determining the cause of his facial droop? And we've gotten some requests to not give away the answer up front here so we can kind of work through these. So let's do it. Answer choice A, ask patient to frown and wrinkle his forehead. B, send patient for CT scan of the head. C, obtain serology for flu infection. D, give clonidine to lower blood pressure. Or E, obtain a nerve conduction test for the seventh cranial nerve. So let's go through what it is that we're looking at. And you can kind of tell from the answers that we're going to be looking at, well, the seventh cranial nerve, specifically because of the symptom that the patient presented with, which was facial droop, and the sign, which shows left-sided facial droop. So the key to answering this question is understanding the anatomy of the facial nerve. So let's look at that. The facial nerve is responsible for the muscles of facial expression. And of course, they're going to be the ones responsible for squinting and for frowning, etc. First thing I want you to look at is right here, which is where the facial nerve nucleus comes from. And you can see there's two of them. There's a right and there's a left. And it has innervation from up above in the frontal cortex, which stimulates it. And then from there, it goes on out as a lower motor neuron to the various places. And again, there's more than two branches of the facial nerve, but the ones that I want you to be aware of for squinting and for frowning is the upper division here and the lower division. Now you'll notice that there's some interesting colors, and this is to show you one point and one point specifically, and that is that the upper division has dual or bilateral innervation, whereas the lower has only contralateral innervation. So let's review that again. So the orange innervation coming from, in this case, the left side, and the yellow coming from the right side. And what you'll notice, if we follow this through, this nerve over here coming from the left frontal cortex is going to come down, and it's actually going to innervate both nuclei, both the left and right nuclei. However, the innervation going contralateral, so the left going over here to the right, is going to be seen in both the upper and lower division. Okay? However, here's the key. The right-sided input from this upper motor neuron is going to cross and go here only to the upper. Okay? And then you have the flip on the other side. So again, here on the right side, you've got the right upper motor neuron coming down and going to both the right nucleus and the left nucleus, but that the left comes down and goes to both as well, but as we said, innervates both upper division of the lower motor neuron. So the effect is this. If you have a stroke in the brain, okay, let's say you had a left-sided stroke in this case, what's going to happen is you're going to lose innervation wherever you see orange. So you're not going to see any contralateral lower facial movement. And you're going to lose some of the upper contralaterally. However, because the right side has some ipsilateral innervation of only the upper, you're never going to lose upper division motor activity. So that's the key here, is that a central stroke, a stroke centrally located up here in the prefrontal or frontal cortex, will never give you a problem with squinting. So the upper portion is preserved because of this dual innervation, but the lower will be. So they will lose the ability to frown on the contralateral side. So because of that, if you ever see a person with the problem on one side where they cannot squint and they cannot frown, then that would tell you that the problem is not centrally located up in the brain, up in the prefrontal cortex, but it must be something that has affected the nerve itself all the way back to the ipsilateral nucleus. So there must be something somewhere along here, because that is the only lesion that would cause both the upper and lower divisions of that area to have a problem. So then, let's go back to our question. In this situation, again, the patient has this sign of left-sided facial droop, and that's as specific as it gets. So we don't know if this is upper, this is lower, this is ipsilateral. It's really not that clear. His symptoms started 5 hours ago. It was noticed by his coworkers. So you're getting the sense here that you've got to make sure that we rule out the worst case scenario, which of course is a stroke, right? So the patient does have an elevated blood pressure, so that makes you concerned that the patient may have a stroke, because that's usually associated with elevated blood pressure. The fact that he doesn't take any blood pressure medicines also kind of makes us a little bit anxious that this could be going on. He's also got some excessive stress in the family. He's had a headache. All of these are just like, wow, kind of make you worry type of thing, right? And then he's got this sick flu-like symptom from 2 weeks ago, which may seem like a red herring, but you're not quite sure. So what's the best test for determining the cause of his facial droop? Well, you're tempted to get a CT scan of the head to make sure that this guy doesn't have a stroke. But you've got to think about what are cost-effective measures that you can put into effect to give you the most accurate diagnosis. Now, we've just said that if you were to have a stroke, a central stroke in the cerebral cortex, that you would never have a loss of muscle function in the upper division of the facial nerve. And the reason for that is that the upper division of the facial nerve bilaterally has bilateral inputs. And so a CT scan is probably not the next best thing that you would want to do. Obtaining serology for flu infection, that's probably not it either, because the flu does not cause these types of problems. Clonidine is not a great medication to give acutely to lower blood pressure. I can think of much better medications, especially in an emergency room, to lower blood pressure medications. For instance, things like labetalol or hydralazine. That could bring blood pressure down much more quickly. Of course, you don't want to bring it down too fast, because if you do that, you could get relative hypotension. Also, coming off of clonidine, which is an alpha-2 agonist, can cause rebound hypertension and tachycardia. A nerve conduction test for the seventh cranial nerve, well, we know that it's not working. The question is why is it not working? And in fact, the best answer for this is to simply ask the patient to frown and to wrinkle his forehead. And what's that going to do? So let's take a look at that with our picture that we had before. So again, the problem is left-sided, which is over here. And if we ask him to frown and to wrinkle his forehead, we're essentially testing both the upper division of the facial nerve and the lower division of the facial nerve. If just the lower division is not working, that would indicate that there's a problem over here with a right-sided stroke. If, on the other hand, he's not able to move either the upper division of this facial nerve and the lower division of this facial nerve, then that would indicate that the problem is actually right here, which would indicate a Bell's palsy. And again, the key to understanding this topic is understanding the anatomy, and specifically that the upper division has dual innervation and the lower division does not. Thanks for joining us.